So hello everyone, and I would like really to thank all the scientific organizers for this meeting, for giving me the opportunity to present at the Aspire meeting, and be happy and pleased also to join the live discussion in 1 month or so. So the topic of my presentation is to discuss with you about the scientific approach behind this potentially new revolution in the field of genetic assessment of embryos through non-invasive methodologies. Here you have the agenda of my presentation, where I will first quickly review the gold standard that we have today for aneuploidy testing, which is a trophetal biopsy method. Then I will go through the different methodologies that have been proposed for non-invasive assessment of the embryonic chromosomal constitution. Then I will show you some of the most relevant studies dealing with the characterization of cell-free DNA in embryonic sperm culture media. And most importantly, I really would like to provide you with a critical appraisal of the available literature on this field, and particularly on the strengths and limitations that we may highlight from the several methodologies and scientific approaches that try to develop data about the non-invasive PGT-A, and what are the main differences between the experimental and the clinical result that we should be considering for evaluating their translability. So as we all know well, PGT-A has got a lot of attention in our field over the past decades. This is because aneuploidies, we know that they are for sure the single most important factor associated with implantation failure, miscarriage, and pregnancy complication in our reproduction. And for sure, we know that the gold standard today is to take a biopsy at the blast stage and perform an NGS analysis that has been a great improvement over the last years, because we have today an approach that is reliable, is effective, as shown in many several different RCTs, as well as clinical experience. And thanks to the NGS today, we also have been able to lower the cost of this procedure and give the opportunity to many more patients to benefit from having their embryo tested for aneuploidies. So we are quite satisfied and about the current gold standard method, which is a diagnostic approach that has also really remarkable predictive value in pregnancy. We know that the biopsy at blast stage is safe, does not provide any effect on reproductive potential, as shown in several class one studies. We have also evidence that there are no major implications for neonatal outcomes following the biopsy, as long as we know the method is reliable. We can analyze a multi-cell biopsy, and thus the genetic analysis is extremely improved and robust in predicting the chromosomal constitution of the embryos if we use proper criteria for aneuploidy classification, and we do not overcall mosaicism as it happens in some cases. And finally, this method is also effective. We have many evidence of clinical effectiveness from RCTs and case control studies. However, we understand that even we have all these preclinical and clinical evidence in place for blast biopsy and PGT-A, this is still not a routine procedure in all IVF clinics. And thus, there is at least a room for improving the procedure in particular contexts or where this procedure cannot be properly applied. So we need for sure to understand that maybe start persisting technical skills and equipment training costs associated with the biopsy procedure that are limiting widespread adoption, and also that there is still some persisting concerns related to the potential damage or discarding of viable embryos due to the poor experience or performance of some embryologists in performing the procedure, or to the use of erroneous criteria for aneuploidy classification. So this is actually the reason why looking for new, less invasive, non-invasive approaches that are easier to be implemented and incorporated in the routine IVF procedures can have a place in a significant role in the future of IVF and embryo selection. So among the most important difference of the new non-invasive scientific approach that has been developed is the fact that first, we do not have to touch the embryo any longer in the way that we can collect the surrounding Spain culture media from the embryos, where the embryo has been growing for the last days of culture, and we can take this media. We only need a Nielsen pipette for collecting the media, do not touch the embryo, and then we can apply similar downstream technologies that we've been using for PGTA analysis in the trophectal biopsies. But one of the main difference then comes with the way that we utilize the results after the NGS analysis. In particular, instead of deselecting the embryos, as we do with a diagnostic approach that is the standard PGTA, we can apply a prioritization strategy according to the SBM results, where we can have a kind of euploidy scores or that will define the transfer prioritization and the grading of embryos for transfer, but at the end, all the embryos can be transferred. By doing so, we do not expect any loss of potentially viable embryos for both damage of the biopsy, the potential damage of the biopsy, if this is not performed properly, or due to the potential false positive results. They are the most important concepts behind the PGTA approach. So while we can be confident and we can invest our time and resources in this approach, mostly because we already have many successful experience with analysis of nucleic acids in liquid biopsy samples. One of the most paramount example is the NIPT, the non-invasive pre-implantation prenatal testing, where we use to collect and isolate fetal cell-free DNA from maternal blood for chromosomal analysis of the fetus. But we have also additional examples, successful experience in general field of medicine and diagnostics, where the use of nucleic acids from lipid biopsies is providing really new and very powerful tools for the early detection of many several diseases from liquid biopsies, such as saliva, blood, or urine samples. If we focus to our field in particular, we need to, and we go more in detail into the scientific approach, we need to understand what can be the potential sources of contamination when we look at the cell-free DNA in the surrounding embryonic environment. So we may have culture media contamination, where we may have some cell-free DNA carryover from the culture media that we use, commercial culture media that we use for growing the embryos. Most importantly, we can have some really important interfering sources of contamination from the maternal genome, in particular from cumulus cells and degenerating polar bodies during the first days of culture. And also, in case we've been performing standard IVF, we may also have to take care about the potential paternal contamination due to the presence of sperm adherent to the zona pellucida. So at the beginning of this development path, we had to ask ourselves several questions. Most important was whether we have enough cell-free DNA from these liquid biopsies that can collect from human embryos in order to apply the common genetic technologies that we use in our PGT analysis. And if so, whether this cell-free DNA is mostly of embryonic origin and represents the chromosomal content of the embryos. The third question that comes later is for sure whether this is tool is providing any clinical utility for patients, and this will be probably answered in the next presentation by Dr. Simon. So I wanted to show you first this very interesting study that was performed by the group of Elizabeth Ammon and colleagues, where they've been analyzing the origin and composition of the sperm culture media and sperm embryonic media conditioned following embryo culture. And they used this metrics, that is the Y autosome ratio in embryo media compared with the control media, in order to assess the origin and composition of this cell-free DNA, and they show that there is a systematic excess of female-derived DNA into these samples. They also show that using Y chromosome markers in embryo media does not provide unequivocally the association with the embryonic gender. That's for the web recommended not to use at that time this approach in 2016 for any genetic assessment because the cell-free DNA was shown to be of mixed origin and not exclusively of embryonic origin. Couple of additional investigations were published soon after. Two independent studies, one from Maria Vera Rodriguez, where they've been performing a comparative analysis between trophectomy biopsies and culture media samples. As you can see here in the slide, they've been performing this paired analysis showing 30% concordance rate, and in 60% of the cases, there were also evidence of maternal contamination. In an independent study, we've been using trio models with where we collect from the same embryo the blastocyst fluid, so a minimally invasive approach for non-invasive analysis, trophectomy biopsy, and the sperm blastocyst media. And we analyze these three samples from patients undergoing PGT for monogenic diseases. We had the chance and the ability also to investigate some haplotype and rare variants segregation patterns in these three samples using the trophectoderm and the parental DNA as support to understand properly the origin and the composition of the sperm blastocyst media and the blastocyst fluid in this case. So, one of the first messages that we obtained at that time was that day six and day seven embryos were much better performing compared to day five embryos for what concern amplification rate. As you can see here, day six and day seven amplified more than provide more genetic material for analysis compared to day five embryos. While for PGT, for what concern the concordance rate with the trophectomy biopsy genotype, you can see that again, the day six and day seven were performing much better compared to day five embryos. That means that the longer is the culture, the higher is the general cell-free DNA that we can analyze, but the cell-free DNA is enriched in embryonic genome. Nevertheless, we observed that in general, the haplotype concordance was very poor, much better for sperm blastocyst media samples compared to blastocyst fluid samples, but still suboptimal when working under standard clinical conditions and embryo culture conditions. I think this is really good examples of how to demonstrate the persistent presence of maternal cell contamination in these liquid biopsies that we can collect at the blastocyst stage, looking at the segregation patterns where we have a heterozygote maternal genotype with a rare variant, rare mutation that cannot come following exogenous or environmental contamination. And we observed segregation pattern where the mother was providing the wild-type allele, where we have identified into the blastocyst fluid and the sperm blastocyst media samples the mutated allele that was not present, of course, in the embryo. So this is quite a direct evidence about the fact that maternal contamination was really an issue and was significantly prevalent in this type of samples when working under standard clinical and embryological conditions. Over the course of the year, we have seen many different studies trying to make correlation and concordance analysis between trophectoderm and sperm blastocyst media in this paired design. And as you can see here, we've also seen very heterogeneous outcomes and very different results. These differences can be explained by the different methodology and scientific approaches employed in these studies, and where particularly none of them, except the study by Carmen Rubio and colleagues in 2019, were performed under standard clinical condition, but most of them, all of them, had some prior kind of prior intervention that may have affected the results and explain the inconsistent data reporting observed across these studies. I wanted now to give you some more critical analysis of some scientific approaches and methodologies that have been employed for investigating this issue and this approach, in particular in this study. The authors were concluding that the knee PGTA approach was superior compared to the trophectoral biopsy in predicting the embryonic chromosomal constitution by performing the analysis of the trophectoral biopsy, the sphagnoblastocyst media versus the whole embryo that was analyzed entirely. So there are some criticalities to analyze, and this is important to also for you to understand the limitations in the translatability and clinical translatability of this approach. Because, for instance, we can see that the experimental design, they use embryos that were vitrified and thawed, so that underwent this round of cryopreservation that is known to induce some sort of stress to the cells in the embryos. Thus, it is expected that if you apply some stress, such as cryopreservation, to an embryo, you will have more cells in the blastocyst that are probably going through cell death and degeneration after thawing, and that this will increase the release, of course, and the concentration of embryonic cell-free DNA into the culture media. These embryos were also cultured for 24 hours after the thawing. So these results for the NIPGTA in this case were not obtained under clinical conditions, of course. But most importantly, when looking at the control group performance, this is really important because they show that trophectoral biopsy was inferior in predicting embryonic chromosomal constitution. But if we look carefully at the performance of this control group of trophectoral biopsy, we saw that this control group is really underperforming compared to all the scientific evidence and the other publications that we have so far assessing and performing multifocal biopsy of human blastocysts, and where trophectoral biopsy is usually very much representative of the remaining embryonic chromosomal constitution. Indeed, here they show that knee PGTA was superior, but was superior because they use an underperforming control group. Well, so they had an unreliable gold standard performance that justified the result. So in general, I would not consider translating the result in the general context of a clinical application of non-invasive PGTA because of this limitation and because the results were not obtained under standard clinical workflow and condition. Another study that has reported some clinical outcomes with the use of non-invasive PGTA was this study by the group of Sun Exim. And again, they have applied a non-invasive approach in order to perform embryo selection on these seven patients that were elected and candidated for embryo chromosomal screening, even if some of them they really do not have indication for genetic testing, such as the inversion of the chromosome 9, which is a polymorphism. And they reported six live births following the transfer of embryos that were evaluated as employed by the non-invasive methodology. But as you all know well, you can get pregnancies even without applying any kind of genetic testing from these patients that are also very young, probably. In some cases, producing high number of embryos. And in this case, in the absence, particularly of a control group, it's impossible to evaluate the performance of the newly developed approach. So without a control group available, it's impossible to assess the effectiveness of this approach. So as I was telling you, the only study so far that has shown concordance results and data in standard clinical and embryological condition is a study by Rubio and colleagues that we have published last year, where we've been applying a kind of improved method for embryo culture for the context of non-invasive analysis of sphagnoblastocyst media by using a final culture drop of 10 microliters. And we have also applied some minor modification to the whole genome amplification protocol in order to increase the DNA yield that I can get from these liquid biopsy and challenging samples. And we have then performed these analyses on over 100 blastocysts and sphagnoblastocyst media samples, showing that the most important factor and parameter that really improves the results is the time spent on the embryo culture. So the distinction between culture media samples that were collected on day five or in day six or seven. As you can see here, by extending the culture to day six and day seven, you can really dramatically improve the results in both terms of informativity and concordance rate. And in particular, this was really a surprise and really unexpected based on our previous experience, where informativity and concordance rate was much lower and below this performance reported here for with this improved protocol for embryo culture and for genetic analysis, and by just looking at day six and day seven embryos. There are, of course, some persisting false negative and false positive results that are kind of easy to be explained for, because this should come as a consequence of maternal DNA contamination from potentially Kummel cells or polar bodies regenerating during the culture. And this is something that can be also worked out much better in the future. And then there are also some level, there were some level of false positive results that are a little bit more challenging to be explained, and that will need more assessment. More recently, we have applied the same design in a context of multicenter prospective trial in order to investigate the reliability of the approach when applied in different IVF settings. As you can see here in this table, it was quite robust and quite reproducible in different IVF settings worldwide, showing around 80% of concordance rate between the trophector or the in the culture media in different settings. We've been also investigating the predictivity of the sperm blastocyst media and the gold standard in defining the chromosomal constitution of the SEM. And as you can see here, the performance were quite more reliable and aligned with what is published in the literature for trophector biopsy. And also the sperm blastocyst media provide 86% concordance rate with the SEM for what concerned the whole chromosome aneuploidies. So in summary, I think that this is a really exciting application and novel, completely novel possibility to explore in our field. That can be a revolution in the next years for the genetic assessment of embryos in a non-invasive way. We still have to fill some gap of knowledge, particularly from the basic research side. We still don't have any clues about how these DNA or cell-free DNA is released into the surrounding environments. We need to figure out and to explore what are the main mechanisms, biological mechanisms behind this process. On the methodology side, I think that we should really look carefully, as I think I've tried to provide you with this understanding that that even subtle differences into the methodologies can have a big impact. Particularly, the culture condition can really affect the results, as well as the criteria that are used for detecting the results and for reporting the outcomes of all the different studies. So we need to look at data that are produced in standard clinical embryological conditions, and we also need to pay attention to which specific methodologies have been used and criteria for classification. This means that since this is a very sensitive point, the data cannot usually be translated from one validated protocol to others, because they are not really translatable if the procedure differs. And that we also have on the methodology side some room for genetic protocols optimization to improve the amplification efficiency and also on the specific detection of embryonic cell-free DNA regions. On the clinical side, I think that, of course, at present time, this is not a diagnostic, a genetic diagnostic tool or application as we have for the biopsy, which provide also important and remarkable predictive value in the pregnancy. But it is a tool that should be used in the context of transfer prioritization, thus not deselecting the embryos. We should apply clinically this technology only on day six embryos, because these are the ones that provide the performance, the best performance that I've been showing to you. And also, we're looking forward for the upcoming randomized trials and clinical experience that are coming for better define understanding the clinical performance of the non-invasive approach for aneuploidy testing in improving the IVF transfer outcomes. So that's it on my side. I'd like to thank you again for listening, and also I'll be looking forward to meet you more in the live discussion more directly. Thank you very much.
Progesterone is a steroid comprising of three cyclohexane rings and one cyclopentane ring. It is manufactured for therapeutic use from the wild yam root Dioscorea species. Due to rapid first-pass liver metabolism, progesterone has variable concentrations and very low oral bioavailability. Therefore, it is administered via injection or vaginal route, which are not easy to use and associated with side effects. Dihydrogesterone was introduced for clinical use under the trade name Duphaston in the 1960s for treatment of conditions associated with progesterone deficiency. The manufacturing process of dihydrogesterone is highly complex. It starts with the chemical modification of progesterone, followed by a critical phase of transformation into dihydrogesterone. This is done by passing it through UV light at an appropriate wavelength, intensity, and time sequence, resulting in a unique, modified retrosteroid structure. This manufacturing process makes dihydrogesterone the only commercially available retroprogesterone. The bent conformation of oral dihydrogesterone enhances the rigidity of the molecule compared to progesterone. Due to its unique structure, dihydrogesterone is highly selective for progesterone receptors, supplementing deficiency of endogenous progesterone. It has negligible interaction with other steroid receptors, resulting in a lack of androgenic, estrogenic, glucocorticoid, and mineralocorticoid effects that can occur with other progestogens. Duphaston, containing 10 mg dihydrogesterone in each tablet, is formulated to have good bioavailability, enabling convenient, patient-friendly oral administration. Improved oral bioavailability and the receptor agonist activity of its metabolites causes secretory transformation of the endometrium, progestational activity, at a dose 10 to 20 times lower than micronized progesterone. Various progestogens have been investigated to support endogenous progesterone in the treatment of luteal phase deficiency. Only duphaston, progesterone, and 17-alpha-hydroxyprogesterone caproate are currently approved for clinical use during pregnancy. In addition, duphaston has a wide range of indications to supplement endogenous progesterone deficiency. It is shown to be effective in irregular menstrual cycles, dysmenorrhea, endometriosis, premenstrual syndrome, and secondary amenorrhea. In women undergoing assisted reproduction, Duphaston supplements endogenous progesterone and provides orally effective luteal phase support, contributing to successful and comparable pregnancy outcomes versus vaginal micronized progesterone. To date, around 113 million women throughout the world have experience with Duphaston, including 20 million fetuses exposed to dihydrogesterone in utero.